All right, welcome to our poetry reading today. My name is Oleh. I'm the manager of publications at the Ukrainian Research Institute. It's a pleasure to welcome all of you to this event, and wonderful to see so many familiar faces, but also several new faces. Please don't be shy. Feel free to speak up, ask questions, and come talk to us after the conversation, and also come join us for other events. And I will use this as an opportunity to announce them ahead of time rather than boring you with them at the end of our conversation. So next week, October the 2nd, from 6 to 8 p.m., in the Belfer Case Study Room in the Sieges South building, we'll have a special event of the Tamar to Contemporary Ukraine program. It's entitled A Just Peace in Ukraine, Activist Policy and Scholarly Perspectives. It's a panel discussion with Alexandra Romantsova, who is the Executive Director of the Center for Civil Liberties in Ukraine. And the center is the recipient of the 2022 Nobel Peace Prize. She participates with Oksana Shevel, Associate Professor of Political Science and Director of the International Relations Program at Tufts University, and with Alexander S. Windman, former Director for European Affairs at the U.S. National Security Council, 2018-2020, and the current House Leader at the Center for Public Leadership of Harvard Kennedy School. Also next week on Wednesday, October the 4th, from 5 to 6:30 p.m., right here where we are in our Omelyan Pritsak, the Founders Library, we have a Ukraine study group discussion with Kirilo Demchenko, who is Ukraine's youth delegate to the UN. Well, please allow me to introduce our guest first, Alex Averbuch. He is a poet, translator, and scholar, the author of 4 books of poetry and an array of literary translations between Hebrew, Ukrainian, English, and Russian. His poetry deals with interwoven Jewish-Ukrainian relations through the prism of his family history and Ukraine's multi-ethnic past and present. The books that we will be reading from today feature poeticized documentary materials related to the Second World War, letters by Ukrainian Ostarbeiters sent to their relatives in Ukraine, interwoven with letters by Jewish Holocaust survivors who returned to devastated villages in Ukraine in search of their murdered relatives, as well as poems about the Russo-Ukrainian war currently taking place in his home region of Luhansk. English translations of Alexander's poems have appeared in the Manhattan Review, Copernicle Plume, Birmingham Poetry Review, Words Without Borders, Sugar House Review, Constellations, and Common Knowledge. His latest book, Zhydivsky Korol, the Jewish King, from which most of the forthcoming English language collection of Rage and Longing derives, was a finalist for the Shevchenko National Prize, Ukraine's highest award for culture and literature. He is active in promoting Ukrainian-Jewish relations, has translated into Hebrew and published over 30 selections of poetry by contemporary Ukrainian poets. Currently, he is compiling and editing an anthology of contemporary Ukrainian poetry in Hebrew translation. At the moment, he is a postdoctoral fellow at the Davis Center for Russian and Eurasian Studies, and next term, HURI research fellow at our Ukrainian Research Institute here. He holds a PhD degree in Slavic languages and literatures and Jewish studies from the University of Toronto. I think this is a very substantial introduction, but in order to contextualize a little bit more the collections themselves and also what motivates you as you write, I would like perhaps to give you 15 to 20 minutes to just kind of talk about some of the themes and topics, you know, that really move you as you write your poetry.
Thank you. 15, 20 minutes, it's a lot. You can write 3 poems in 15 minutes. But thank you, Oleh, first of all, for the introduction, and thank you for coming here today. It's really a huge honor for me to read my poetry along with the translations today here. of course, I want to express my gratitude to the sponsors of this event, to HURI, Davis Center, Slavic Department, the Center for Jewish Studies. It's quite important that all these institutions collaborate, including the Jewish Studies. It's important. I also want to acknowledge that this event and our peaceful life here is happening simultaneously during all the horrors that are happening back in Ukraine, and that in these very moments people are killed, people are suffering, and I think that poetry in this sense, poetry about war, and not only about war, is a form of solidarity that we can express, we can support somehow through our poetry, our brothers and sisters in Ukraine. My book, this and previous books, and upcoming one, deals a lot with documentary materials. I use a lot of documentary materials, which I stylize them. First of all, I'm fascinated by these materials, by their language primarily. But these materials pertain to horrible events that Ukraine and Ukrainian, Ukraine's peoples went through the last century. Of course, for this book, the Second World War and the current war, which is happening since 2014 in the place that I was born and grown up, are central topics. Its presence is substantial, is important to me. But I guess that these topics and these issues, these motifs are transnational. When I write about, for example, about Holocaust, and I don't write about it explicitly, people write to me and express their attachment to those poems in a different context. And I'm so happy that this happens, because this is about solidarity. They find something that is appealing to them. They find some resonance, echo, and I hope very much that it heals them. I also would like to say a couple of words about, because today you will be listening to both to the originals and to the translations, and this is also about solidarity and collaboration with my wonderful co-creators, Oksana Maksimchuk and Max Rosuchinsky, with whom I started to collaborate a couple of years ago while we were working on a piece for a poetic cycle for the anthology of Ukrainian Jewish poetry. And I am myself a translator, and it's a very bad thing to be a translator, to collaborate with translators when you understand a target language. I understand English, and it was very risky to collaborate with me, and it was very risky also to agree to such a process. It's a very painful process when you allow others to transform your texts, to put them in a different language, appealing to the readers in this language. But I was so lucky, and they are not the only translators that I have been working with, but the extent, the willingness to understand much more, to understand the context, to understand more than I understand even in these poems. This is what make this collaboration, this not collaboration, co-creation, because they are co-creators, so pleasing and joyful. I would like also to I mentioned that many of these poems they are based on documents, for example, letters by Ostarbeiters, Ukrainian forced labor workers during the Second World War, who were allowed to send letters, who were allowed to correspond with their relatives back in Ukraine. Fascinated me by their language. These are very short messages, 10, 15 lines, very typical ones, what they're living through, what they eat, what are the conditions, but the language, this was a miracle for me. I grew up in a bilingual environment. Sozhuk for me, Sozhuk, a mix of Ukrainian, Russian, the Russian language, was very natural, but I was always a little bit ashamed of this language, because it's not a proper language. You're not supposed to use it in many contexts, in many interactions. And when I saw a huge amount of these postcards written by subliterate, mainly women, it was a treasure, and I was reading thousands of these letters, and when you read a lot of texts written in this language, you want to, it's like a core, you want to join it, you want to continue, you want to sing with them. So when I used these testimonials, and they are testimonials, they are historical sources about the well-being of these people in Germany, I was tempted to write poetry based on, it was actually already poetry, it was poetry. But these are testimonials. And another cycle from this book is also based on correspondence. I'm crazy about correspondence and letter writing, and my current project, by the way, is also about letter writing. But the other cycle is based on very short letters, like telegrams, sent by Jewish survivors to their neighbors after the Second World War, to their neighbors back in various villages, shtetls in Ukraine, inquiring about their relatives, whether they survived or they not, and what happened to their estates, to their houses, very short ones. And these are mixed with the letters of survivors. But once again, I'm a bit obsessed with the testimonials and this, the borderline between literature and history, because we are dealing with fiction. And the question is often asked, so what should we trust those sources, should we not, is it, to what extent, where the invention, where the fiction ends and where the history starts, or vice versa. This book is also about the reason why I mixed these two types of correspondence is because I wanted to mix two sufferings, two horrible experiences of these two peoples who cohabited for centuries and sometimes, and I'm quite happy about it, people even don't understand that these are letters by two different groups, which is fine. I mean, it's a little bit funny, but I am happy that this kind of impression that they get. So this book is also a book of excuses, because I do want to reconcile. I do want various parts of the Ukrainian past, of course, from my family history, to reconcile, to talk through these texts, through my body, and the bodily experience is central for my poetry and for this book. But this book is also about rage and longing, as the forthcoming one is titled, because there is always rage, there is always anger and lack of understanding and longing for our ancestors, for the lands, for the places that are dear and distant and inaccessible now to many of us, to many Ukrainians. And of course, the last thing that I would like to emphasize about poetry and the book is its liturgical mode. Well, of course, poetry is always about, it is very much connected to religion, to the prayers. And I indeed use a lot of prayers in this book, both in Hebrew and in Ukrainian. And it was important to inscribe Jewish prayers in Hebrew in Ukrainian transliteration, because in my opinion, Jews are indigenous people of Ukraine, and Hebrew and Yiddish are indigenous languages of Ukraine, and these languages should be voiced and heard not only by those who understand them, but also by people who don't. So this is about presence and recognition as well. So I guess this was my introduction about the book, about the context and my attachment to the documents.
Let me just kind of jump in before we go into the readings. When we were chatting before the event, you mentioned that this beautiful cover of the book actually depicts two of your grandparents, or great, one of them is great grandfather. One is on the Jewish side, and the other one is on the Ukrainian side. And so, kind of that, you know, the question I wanted to ask you before we go into reading is about where you come in, right? The book is entitled "The Jewish King," which is a beautiful metaphor and a beautiful kind of, you know, term in itself. But where do you come in as, you know, as an author? From which position do you feel you are speaking? And who is that audience that you think you are speaking to? Is it someone present or someone who is not there anymore, or both?
Yeah, the cover is actually designed by my partner. And it's very, I mean, I'm happy that the translations are done by a married couple. It has this symbolism of conceiving, of being impregnant by texts and ideas and giving birth to something. But yes, indeed, yes, this is a Jewish Croat grandfather and a Ukrainian grandfather. I write a lot to, on behalf and about dead people. I do communicate with them. I think that they present and they exist in different forms. They surround us in the objects that they left behind. They exist in various notes. The other day, I visited Israel this summer, and my grandmother passed away a couple of years ago, and she left a mobile phone, and my mom kept paying for it. She even didn't know where the phone was, and then we found it, and I turned it on, and guess what I discovered? A lot of voice messages left to her, because she died on Shabbat, and we were in rush to bury her, and no, almost nobody came to the funeral, and people didn't know, and we didn't let them know. But she exists, she's present for them, for us, for me, by these little messages that are addressed to her. To answer your question, who is my audience? I don't know. I want to write both for people who are alive and for the dead, and I want to keep them with me, with us, because they still have what to say to us. They want to be present, I can assure you.
Okay. That strikes very close. I recognize so many of these experiences, and it's just so wonderful that you talk about this, and are able to talk about this in such an eloquent way. So our reading today and conversation are, you know, both are kind of divided in four parts. And so we talk briefly about each part, but why don't you introduce the first part more broadly, and then we go into reading, and then maybe we chat a little bit, and then proceed to the second part.
Yeah, let's do it. So the first part, this is, by the way, Valerie. She's a grad student, and she will be reading the translations from the English translations, and we were talking about how to do it just before the event. And I suddenly realized that the order of the poems that I will be reading today is completely different from how it appears in the book. So it is a different book, and the structure is different and appealing to me as I sense it today. So the first part, I decided to make a sort of poetic introduction. Who is Alexander Averbuch? Where he comes from? Who are his ancestors? What are his troubles? What does he want? It will be very short, three poems. So I will start from this, then we will move to a more contemporary reflections on what's going on in the world, in Ukraine, and then I will read a couple of a few poems from the documentary Ostarbeiters, correspondence based cycle, and we'll finish with the Jewish correspondence cycle, which is not only correspondence, but you will figure it out. So I will begin. I will read in Ukrainian, and Valerie will read in English. Книга родоводу Олександрового, сина Давидового, сина Авраамового. Авраам породив Ісака,
Ісаак породив Якова, Яків породив Юду і братів його, Юда ж породив Фареса та Зару від Тамари. Фарес же породив Ісрома, а Ісром породив Арама, Арам породив Амінадава, Амінадав же породив Наасона, Наасон породив Салмона, Салмон же породив Вооза від Рахави, а Вооз породив Йовіда від Рути. Йовід же породив Єсея, а Єсей породив Давида. Давид же породив Лейзера від Басшеви Буріхової у Чорткові. А Лейзер породив Ісраїля від Сари в окопах Святої Трійці. І як народився Баал Шемтов, то було батькам його по 100 років. І не мали вони окрім нього дітей і померли, як Бештові 5 рочків було. І вештався він по хащах, шукаючи Бога, аби задобрити його. І знайшовши, породив від хани Малки у Бродах Цві Гірша та Аделю. Аделя ж породила Фейгу від Єхієля Шкеназі Стульчина. І були в них ще Мойше Хайм, Борух Шмуль та Ян Кельйов. Фейга ж породила Меджібожі Нахмана. А той Нахман із Братслава породив від Саші Єфраймової Аделю, що породила від Йоськи Авербуха з Хмельника Авраама Довабера. Авраам Довбер же породив Довіда в Чигирині. Довід же породив Боруха від Ліби Товби з Медведівки. І тоді вже народився від Боруха Ісосі Сури Аронової в Бершеді Герц. Герц же породив Довіда, Боруха, Рахілю, Шейну та Зислю від Сими Бенюміновою Дашові. Рахіля породила Луїзу Людмилу від Віктора Донецьку. Віктора ж породив Карл Освуд з Менонітів Новгородському. Луїза Людмила ж породила Наталю від Володимира Богуслава з Кракова, що з неї родився Олександр. А всіх поколінь від Авраама аж до Давида 14, а від Давида аж до переселення в Україну та великого змішання поколінь 14. Народження ж Олександра сталося так. Ще до того, як його матір заручено з Михайлом з Новоїдару, та перш ніж зійшлися вони, виявилося, що вона має в утробі Олександра. А Михайло, не бувши праведним, ославив її і не прийняв її, бо не хотів Олександра, зачатого від нього. А Наталя хотіла вродити сина і дати йому імення Олександр, щоб він захистив її і не ославив більше. Як прокинулася зі сну, то зробила, як звелено її, і не позбулася його, і не вискребла. І не знав Олександр, подяку матері своїй, батька свого, Михайла Володимирового, ані діда свого, Володимира Костянтинового, ані бабу свою, Ніну Миколаєву, ані сестру свою кровну сліпу, не знав і не бачив ніколи, як вони жили в Ростові на вулиці Єрьомінка, 82, квартира 803. Як щоранку ходив на роботу батько його, цього він не бачив і не знав. Як сестра у темних окулярах виходила із жінкою під руку, не бачив і не знав їх ніколи. І спитав себе, хто зрішив, вона чи батько її, що сліпою народилася? Вона не зрішила, бо не знала, що батько вчинив. Промовив це і допоміг зціленню сліпою. Отож подалася та, куди казав їй, і повернулася зрячою. Сусіди ж і ті, що бачили її раніше сліпою, заговорили, чи то ж не та, яка ото все ходила в окулярах? І вона сказала, це я. Тож питалися, як воно так, що прозріли твої очі? А вона, чоловік, що братом моїм звався, на поміч прийшов, та й мовив, піди та зроби. І я пішла та зробила, що він казав. Вони її тоді питають, де він? Не знаю, каже та, бо не бачила його. І ніхто його не бачив, і не чув про нього все життя, окрім сліпої, що казала. Одне знаю, що то брат мій від батька мого родився, а як він тепер, не знаю, і хто сповісти йому, де я, не відаю. І зустрівши її, промовив до неї, віриш, що я батьків син? Тоді та сказала, вірую, брате, і поклонилася йому, і обняла його, і розридалася.
The book of the generation of Alexander, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham begot Isaac, Isaac begot Jacob, Jacob begot Judas and his brethren, Judas begot Pharez and Zara by Tamar, and Pharez begot Hezron, and Hezron begot Aram. Aram begot Aminadab, and Aminadab begot Naasson. Naasson begot Salmon, and Salmon begot Boaz by Rahab. Boaz begot Obed by Ruth, and Obed begot Jesse. Jesse begot David, and David begot Lazar by Bathsheba Urichova in Chortkiv. And Lazar begot Israel by Sarah in Akope Sveltoi Trice. And when Baal Shem Tov was born, both his parents were 100 years old, and they had no other children beside him, and died when Besht was 5. And he wandered around in the wild, searching for God to appease him. And having found him, Besht begot Zvi Hirsch and Adelia by Hannah Malka in Brode. And Adelia bore Feha of Yehiel, Ashkenazi from Tulchin. And they also had Moishe Chaim, Baruch Shmuel, and Yankel Yov. Feha gave birth to Nachman and Medjibish. And Nahem out of Bratslav begot Adelia by Sasha Ephraimova. Adelia bore Avram Dovber of Yoska Averbuch from Chmilnik. Avram Dovber begot David in Chihirin. David begot Baruch by Liba Topa from Medvedivka. And then Herz was born of Sosa Sura Aranova to Baruch in Bershad. And Herz begot David, Baruch, Rahilia, Shena, and Zislia by Sima Benyaminova in Dashev. And Rahilia bore Louisa Ludmila of Victor in Donetsk. And Victor had been fathered by Karl Oswald of the Mennonites in Novohorodske. And Luisa Ludmila bore Natalia of Volodymyr Bohuslava from Krakow. And from Natalia there was born Alexander. So all the generations from Abraham to David are 14. And from David until the exodus to Ukraine and the great intermixing are 14 generations. Now the birth of Alexander was on this wise. Even before his mother was espoused to Mikhailo from Novaya Dar, and before they came together, it had turned out that she carried Alexander in her womb. And Mikhailo, not being a righteous man, disgraced her, and he did not take her as his wife, because he did not want Alexander conceived by him. Yet Natalia wanted to bring forth a son and call him by the name of Alexander, so that he would protect her and would not be a disgrace to her. And as she woke from her sleep, she did as she was commanded, and did not get rid of him, nor did she scrape him out. And Alexander knew, thanks to his mother, neither his father, Mikhailo, born of Volodymyr, nor his grandfather, Volodymyr, born of Konstantin, nor his grandmother, Nina, born of Mykolai, nor his blind half-sister, never knew her, nor did he see her ever, that they lived in Rostov on Don's Yeremenka Street, 82-2, apartment 803, that every morning his father went to work. Alexander neither saw it nor knew of it, that his sister in dark shades went out arm in arm with a woman, never had he seen them nor known them, and he asked himself, who had sinned, she or her father, that she was born blind? It was not she who had sinned, for she did not know what her father had done. Thus spoke he, and helped heal the blind woman. She went whither he had told her to go, and she returned sighted. The neighbors, therefore, and those who had seen that she was blind, said, isn't she the one who had been wearing dark shades? And she said, I am she. Therefore said they unto her, how were thine eyes opened? She answered and said, the woman who called himself my brother came to my aid and said unto me, go there and do so. And I went there and did as he had ordered. Then they said unto her, where is he? She said, I know not, because I did not see him, and nobody had ever seen him or heard of him except for the blind woman, who said, I know only that he is my brother, begotten of my father. How he is now I do not know, nor who told him where to find me. Having met her, he said unto her, dost thou believe that I am the son of our father? She answered and said, I believe, brother. She bowed down before him, embraced him, and broke into tears.
Я пробачив собі прадіда українця, що ходив погромом на прадіда єврея. Пробачив прабабу польку, яка рвала коси прабабі єврейці. Я пробачив собі прадіда москаля, який забрав останній шматок у прабабу українки. Я пробачив прабабу єврейку, що написала донос на прадіда українця. Вони всі зараз тут, на останній вечері мого тіла. Налягають на стіл. Кожне тягне за серце.
підіймається, відрізає клапти, показує іншим. Бачите, це наше. І я не встигаю запитати кожним відірваним шматочком, за що стою руба? Іште на спомин про себе, тіло моє, пийте з мене, любі, бабцю, дід.
I forgave myself for my Ukrainian great-grandfather who joined a pogrom against my Jewish great-grandfather. I forgave my Polish great-grandmother who tore at the braids of my Jewish great-grandmother. I forgave myself for my Moscow great-grandfather who took the last bit of food from my Ukrainian great-grandmother. I forgave my Jewish great-grandmother who informed on my Ukrainian great-grandfather. They are all here now at the Last Supper of my body, leaning on the table. Each of them pulls at my heart, rises up, carves out a slice, trots it out, look, this is ours. And I have no time to ask with my every torn piece, why am I on the line? Eat my flesh in memory of yourselves. Drink of me, dearly beloved, grandmother, grandfather.
And the next poem is a contemporary one. It reflects on the late January a missile strike on the children's hospital, children's ward in my in the village that I was born, Novaidar, in Luhansk region, and this rocket hit. Probably you heard about it, and completely destroyed the children's ward. Where Russian soldiers were actually were hiding and receiving treatment. And so the poem reflects on these multiple disasters and the very cynical use by the invaders, the use of the children's hospital to receive treatment as a hiding place. So the poem is called Російські солдати спочивають. Російські солдати спочивають у ліжечках дитячого корпусу Новоайдарської лікарні. Пухленькі мутанти велетні, сповиті у пелюшки мого дитинства, російські солдати керзаками вибивають кордони наших затісних колисок, витягуються, роз'являють пащі, просять каші і гречі, вдень і вночі смокчуть нафтові соски, передять природним газом. Далеко від Кострами і Рязані російські солдати у вісні скрикують: «Матушка, батюшка, Боже царя, храні! Велика страна моя родная, победа, один народ, нефть, газ, балет, розхристані, безголові, безрукі, ніби розтрощені ляльки моїх тіток, якими грався у дитинстві, російські солдати не дають собі ради. Хто ними бавитиметься тепер? Хто вдягне у светрик, натягне спідничку, пришиє відірвану голівку, вкрутить пусте тільце ручки та ніжки? Розкидані по лабіринтах дитячого відділення Новоайдарської лікарні, таких безкінечних і темних, таких совєтських, таких моїх. Це туди прабаба Рахіля, велика, глуха, руда жінка, принесла мене у вересні 85-го на таємне обрізання. Це там я обіцяв лікарці, що зроду не бачила такої піпіськи і обличчя. У лабіринтах дитячого відділення на Новоайдарської лікарні на стендах великі шприци, язикотримачі, клізми, затискачі, ікони Леніна і Кравчука, і ще якогось беззубого хлопчика. Усім трьом я молився, аби у мене не було каріесу, і до 12 рочків не їв солодкого. Великі і темне, як церква Московського патріархату, дитяче відділення дитячої лікарні, дитячого Новоайдару, мало два дитячі поверхи. На першому, зігнувши навпіл крихітне тільце і стягнувши штанічки, робили за зішкріп на гостриків. На другому, на холодне і прозоре, як дитячі спогади, скельце вичавували з мізинчика крапельки крові. А нині у дитячих ліжечках дитячого відділення Новодарської лікарні у визвольному перегарі під обламками імперської турботи спочили російські солдати. І жодного беззубого хлопчика не зачепило, кажуть місцеві, що бачили у дитячому відділенні мого королівства спокій і темну ніч, прозору, як зраду, як дзюркотіння в очі, як божу росу, як слинявий поцілунок сусідів, як згарище перешкод перед осліплені від лютій туги.
Russian soldiers are resting on cots in the children's ward of Novaya Dar Hospital. Chubby giant mutants wrapped in the diapers of my childhood. Russian soldiers in their tarpaulin boots break the boundaries of our two narrow cradles. They stretch, they open their maws, they ask for kasha. Day and night, they suck oil from baby bottles and fart out natural gas. Far from Kostroma and Ryazan, Russian soldiers cry out in their sleep, Matushka, Matushka, God save the Tsar, wide is my motherland, victory, where one people, oil, gas, ballet. Disheveled, headless, armless, like the broken dolls my aunts had that I used to play with as a child, the Russian soldiers are at a loss. Who will play with them now? Who will put a sweater on them, pull a skirt on them, sew back the torn off head, screw the hands and legs into the empty bodies scattered throughout the labyrinths of the children's ward of the Novaya Dar Hospital. So endless and dark, so Soviet, so mine. That's where my great-grandfather Rahilia, a big, deaf, red-haired woman, brought me in September 1985 for his secret circumcision. That's where I pissed on the face of the doctor who had never seen such a wee-wee. In the labyrinths of the children's ward of the Novaya Dar Hospital, there are stands with big syringes, tongue clamps, enemas, forceps, icons of Lenin and Kravchuk, and some toothless boy. I prayed to all three to keep me safe from cavities and did not eat sweets until I was 12. Big and dark as the Church of the Moscow Patriarchate, the children's ward of the children's hospital in the children's Novaya Dar had two children's floors. On the first, as you were bending your tiny body in half and pulling down your pants, they scraped you for pinworms. On the second, on a glass as cold, so cold and transparent as childhood memories, they squeezed out from your little finger drops of blood. And now on cots of the children's ward of the Novaya Dar Hospital with the stale reek of liberation on their breaths and under the wreckage of imperial solicitousness, Russian soldiers went to their rest. And no toothless boy was killed, say the locals who saw in the children's ward of my kingdom, peace and dark night, transparent as treason, as a jet of pee in the eyes, as the spit of God's dew, as the slobbery kiss of our neighbors, like an obstacle course for those blinded by rage and longing.
So now, I'll move to the second part.
Actually, let me jump in really quick so that we can kind of maybe ask just a few questions. So the first poem, what I found really interesting was that you kind of, you had both the genealogy, but you also had the kind of the mapping of the topology too, right? So especially kind of after the exodus, you know, Kyiv and this and that, right? All of the kind of city and towns. And so I was just wondering how those two parts come together for you, right? How important it is to kind of the rootedness in place, not just, you know, through generations. Maybe if you could just a couple of words about that.
Well, this is a genealogy of family. Beresht Baal Shem Tov was the founder of Hasidism in Ukraine, and the Rabbi Nachman was his grandson, great-grandson. So these are real people who live, who
born in those locations in Ukraine. So it's also to a certain extent a documentary poetry, because it's about genealogy of my family, about all the Averbuch who lived in Dashiv. Dashiv is a shtetl where my grandmother was born, and I write about loss of Dashiv and loss of Malaydar as two calamities. And I'm in a way returning to those places to re-explore them through the Hispanic history. So of course, the genealogy, but also rootedness in a very specific places, location, geography is very important to me. And as I said, this is Jewish Ukraine.
And then the second part about that, kind of the performance of the miracle, right? Kind of the, which is very biblical, kind of Old Testament, but also could be New Testament as well, right? Kind of the new Messiah or the prophet, right? Kind of meeting, telling what to do, and kind of facilitating a miracle, and through that being recognized. This kind of return, is that part of the return to the family or reclamation of the family? How do you see that?
Well, my sister is indeed blind, and I gave money for the operation. In a way, it's a return, but of course, I always wanted to be recognized by this part of the family, by my father, and to see the faces, to see the face of my sister, who looks like me, but I'm the only child, and I never had this experience of siblings who look like me, and suddenly I see a person who is very, whose face is like mine. So it's a miracle, but in a very specific way, a miracle which is a real story.
Yeah. And then the last, before we continue, so in this last poem that is so powerful, I find, about the Russian soldiers in the children's war. For the first time, there is this word kingdom, right? And kind of, so it's obviously, it's both, you know, an autonomy and a metaphor for a space, but that kingdom, so it, you know, is located in Novaida, and that children's hospital is a part of it. How is that, how does it fit with the event itself that is happening? So it's an attack onto your...
Well, I am the king, I'm the Jewish king. So it's my kingdom. I am a child who lost his kingdom. It's a very small place. I mean, you can Google Davaidar and the hospital. It's two floors. But on Telegram, I even saw the videos how people got inside after the what happened. Sure. And I recognized all the corridors. I know where each room is located. I remember the doctor's cabinets, and you know the rooms and but it's a tiny place. It's just imagine a hospital in a village in a selishche miskoe tipu. Yes, and my great grandma. She was a doctor, she passed away in 1995, and I even used to go because she worked almost till her last years as a radiologist, and so for me, this place is in a way a kingdom, because I felt so comfortable, and now it is destroyed, literally.
Thank you. Let's go to part two. Just a few words maybe about it before we start with the video.
It's all, it's intermixed, it's that the texts are before the full-scale invasion and also after. I wrote a few poems after February 2022. They are also related, connected to events. For example, this, the point that I will start from, was written after the liberation of Izum. If you remember how all the horrible these places of torture and people with wires on their hands were discovered, so it relates to the current events and to the events since 2014.
Хочу, аби ти пам'ятав, аби у гарячці свого Божого марення бачив усіх водночас, вдягнутих в тіло, нанизаних на сухі кістки, як пускав без хребетних до черева, як коріння без тямних дерев рвало на бряклі легені, як стягнув руки дротом, наче у день спокути. Хочу, аби у своїй безсонній божості чув до скінчення себе цей нестерпний, збентежений крик, аби бачив, як зростив соковиту траву у ламких грудях замість черствого серця, як згодував очі братським могилам. Ти знов помилився, бо запеклі уста, пришиті до підмогильного стогону, втратили волю молитися прив'ялі у вазі твоїй. Ти знов помилився, кинувши на підвальну підлогу не тих і не там. Ти помилявся раз за разом, коли голос, заплямований білою іржею твого випробування, ковтав останні слова. Як тобі там, нині і прісно, сидиться, коли чуєш ім'я своє? Чуєш? Небо не витримує твого позіхання і рветься на шматки людської зневіри. Що тобі видно з престолу твоєї байдужості? І ще, скажи, як молитися твоїй втомі тепер?
I want you to remember, so that in the fever of your holy daydreaming you would see everyone at once, dressed in body, strung on dry bone, how you let the worms into the womb, how the roots of the frenzied trees tore at the swollen lungs, how you bound hands bound with wire, like on the Day of Atonement. In your sleepless holiness, I want you to hear to the very end of your being this bewildered, unbearable scream. I want you to see how you raise luscious grass in the fragile chest instead of the hardened heart, how you fed the eyes to the mass graves. You've erred again, for the stubborn lips sewn to the gravestone groan, lost their will to pray to your wilting attention. You've erred yet again, having thrown onto the cellar floor the wrong people in the wrong place. You've erred, been wrong, time and again, when the voice stained with white rust of your trial swallowed the last words. How do you rest now in all eternity when you hear us call your name? Do you hear? Sky can no longer bear your yawning, torn to pieces of human despondency. What do you see from the throne of your indifference? And also, tell, how to pray to your weariness from now on?
So the next poem is is about occupation.
Як повернутися до міста, якого нема? Додому. Як повернутися, якщо його, як горя, важкого нема? Перейменовані вулиці, наче розпухлі судини, не знаходять місце впадіння. І ти стоїш по горло в цьому паводкові, плутаєшся, чим відчинити йому двері, ключиком на мотузці, який загубив у сонливому метушінні за пазухою, і не знайти його у цій вирві, у смужках запотілої тканини чи паперу, наче у самому серці гірських порід, де навіть обвали не розкривають повітрю, внутрішню будову гір. І нарешті увійти. Увімкнути світло, але не бачити затуманілих облич. Вимкнути і не бачити, як постарішав. Наважитися запитати врешті-решт, як я помер. Густий духмяний пил оточує розбещену пам'ять. І лягти у ліжко, щоб прокинутися 35-річним. У домі, у ліжку, обмацуючи руками, губитися, шукати вільного місця поруч мовчазних дідів. Поки тобі не сказали, стрімким падінням ґрунту, незморщене, незадоволене обличчя. Збирайся, збирайся, але ти вже не розумієш, що це не до тебе. Питаєш, любі, де я маю бути тепер? Де прощаються нині з собою?
How do you return to a town which does not exist? To a home, how to return when it no longer exists like a heavy sorrow? Streets with changed names, swollen vessels that can't find an estuary. And you stand in this blood up to your throat, getting mixed up how to open the door for it, with a key on a string that you've lost, sleepily fumbling under your shirt. You can't find it now in this whirl, in the ribbons of damp fabric or paper layered tightly as rock strata, where even a landslide would not expose the interior of a mountain. Finally, to go in, turn on the light, and still not see the fogged up faces, turn it off, without noticing how you'd aged, daring to ask at last, how did I die? Thick, fragrant smoke encircles pampered memory, and you lie down in bed to wake up as a 35-year-old in that house, feeling around the bed you get lost, looking for space amidst the sullen ancestors, until you're told with the sudden falling of soil onto a wrinkled, contorted face, get ready, get ready, and not yet realizing that it isn't addressed to you. You ask, my beloveds, and where am I to go now? Where does one say goodbye to oneself these days?
Війна, війна, на деревах брункує війна, солона, як вибух, війна, страх голодних пустель, подорожує нами війна, глек, налитий свинцем і сонцем, несе причастям війна, вигорілими очима, зазирає до облич, зібраних у вузол війни. Обрубкуваті кінцівки осель мацає засмаленими щупальцями. Війна суцільними дзеркалами вичавлює з себе квіти війни. Війна причепурюється, вплітає до вінка свого сорому нутрощі домівок, невідомі їй імена та географію. Уквічена смертю, тремтячою головою йде стара гербарій війна. Стара й мертва, брязкальце війна, рачки повзе, лахмітниця війна. Сива насуплена, з підв'язаним підборіддям, лежить на столі, неумита, німа війна. І ніхто не хоче її поховати.
Trees are budding with war, salty like an explosion, war. Fear of famished deserts begotten in us by war. A jug filled with burning lead, it offers to us like a sacrament, war. With its faded eye glares into faces, gathered into knots of war. Feels the stumps of dwellings with its greasy tentacles, war. Out of unbroken mirrors, squeezes flowers of war. Hurting up, she weaves into a wreath of shame the innards of homes, names and toponyms unknown to her. Bedecked in blossoms of death, on its tremulous head, it trudges on an ancient herbarium. War. A worn-out expired rattle. War. A creeping bag lady. War. Gray and grim, its chin tied to its head, laid out on the table, unwashed and dumb. War. And nobody dares bury it.
Він був там не один. Його тягло до своїх. Вони стояли на протилежному березі, майже не торкаючись ґрунту. і вказували повільними рухами у напрямку перешийка. Перейди, наче приглушений гомін, приспаної в серці зливи, спогади й досі трималися течії. Скаламучена тікала за рибами та водоростями на велику землю, винувато озираючись на затуманілі береги Айдару. Стебла очерету гульками, повними брунатною тугою, билися глухо й темно один об одного, розпорошуючи до води затужавілий пух. Наче минуле, що конче маєш струсити кудись додолу. На себе, як яблука, що не котяться від яблуні, куди ти їх не шпиняй. Як первинне ім'я, на нього й досі озираєшся. Підійди, підійми, але ти стоїш і стоїш здичавілою яблунькою, що останнім живим коренем тягнеться до пекла свого дому.
He wasn't there alone. He was drawn to his own. They stood on the other side of the river, barely touching the soil, and pointed with slow gestures in the direction of the isthmus. Cross it, like the muted noise of the rainfall lulled to sleep inside one's heart, memories kept to the stream. Muddied, it ran, following fish and tangle, to the great land, guiltily turning back to glimpse the foggy banks of Idar. The reeds, their tops filled with umber sorrow, dully struck one another, sprinkling, tightened down over the water. Like the past, you must shed, shuck off somehow, over your own self. Like apples that refuse to roll away from the tree, no matter how hard you kick them. Like the primal name still compelling you to turn when it's called out. Come here, pick it up. Yet here you remain, standing, a wild apple tree, reaching with its last living root for the abyss that is its home.
У 22-му моя семирічна прабаба Рахіля бігала на горище видивлятися, як до Дашева тягнеться березень. Але бачила лише неоглядний німий голод, що старими синіми губами висмоктував тепло з її замовклих сестер. Моя прабаба Рахіля згадувала, як у 22-му сусід Бондаренко приніс до хати цілу жменю макухи. Сказав матері: «Загорни в ганчірку та дай це смоктати малим Шейні і Зислі, аби дотягнули до березня». Два крихітні мішечки кісток Шейну і Зислю батько Герц поховав на городі. Та прабаба Рахіля й досі пам'ятала смак розм'яклої макухи. Дві останні заслинені грудочки, з яких мати Сима зварила зупу в лютому 22-го року.
In the year 1922, my 7-year-old grandmother Rahelia would run to the attic to watch March reaching out for the village of Dashiv. What she saw was a boundless, dumb famine, sucking warmth with its aged blue lips out of her silent sisters. My great-grandma Rahelia remembered how in the year of 1922, their neighbor Bondarenko brought a handful of cattle feed, said to her mother, "Wrap it up in a rag and give it to the little ones, Shena and Zislia, something to suckle on to make it through the winter. Two tiny bags of bones, Shena and Zislia, Father Herz buried in the garden." And great-grandmother Rahelia still remembered the taste of mushy cattle feed, two last salivious lumps, out of which Mother Sima made soup in the famished February of the year 1922.
I will read a couple of two poems
from the Ostarbeiters cycle. This cycle occupies actually almost one third of the book, but I will read only two.
25 жовтня 43-го року. Добрий день, мої родителі, батько і мати. Перш за все передаю вам свій скучний привіт. Повіщаю, що я жива, здорова, чого й вам желаю, як на кращого життя на своїй рідній батьківщині. Тату і маму, сповіщаю я вас, що я ваших 6 откриток, за котрі я вам щиро дякую, що ви за мене не забуваєте, а я за вам ніколи не забуваю. Я до вас уже написала більше 20 откриток, а ви писали, що тільки 2 отримали. То я не знаю, що це воно робиться. Просю вас, не журіться, тільки моліться Богу. Якщо дасть Бог, що будемо то живі, то побачимося. Мамо, мамочка, рідненька, болить серце, болить тяжко. У чужій стороні моя ненько, закувала зозуленька. Сидя на дудочку, плаче мати на Вкраїні. Дочка на чужині. На це не буду кончать. До свідання. Передаю я вам всім привіт. Передаю привіт усім вам.
25th of October, 1943. Good day, my dear parents, father and mother. First of all, I send you my wistful greetings, informing you that I am alive and well, and I wish the same to you, and the best life in our native fatherland. Tato and Mama, I inform you that I received your 6 postcards, for which I sincerely thank you, that you're not forgetting about me. And I never forget about you. I've already sent you more than 20 postcards, but you wrote you only got 2, so I don't know what's happening. But please don't worry. Just pray to God, God willing, if we survive. Then we'll see each other. Mama, Mamachka, my beloved mother, my heart aches so deeply in the strange land. My sweet ma, count my years, cuckoo bird, sitting on an oak branch, mothers weeping in Ukraine, daughters in a foreign land. This is how I'll end. I bid farewell to all of you and send greetings to everyone.
Лист писаний 13 червня 43-го року. Лист до своїх дорогих, ніколи не забутні, папаші, мамаші і родних братиків, Васюні і Альошки. Поздравляю вас, мої дорогесенькі, Святою Троїцею, бо пишу цю відкритку на саму Троїцю рано у неділю, коли ще вся кімната спить. Ой, мамусю, дорогесенькі, пишу, а сльози котяться. Як згадаю, що так я далеко від вас, то горко заплачу. Хоч, може, дома тепер не мед, але дома. Ой, Боже, як згадаю, що весна в колгоспі, робити весело, то й душі не стане. І Великдень пройшов, а ми ні Пасхи, ні крашенки не бачили. Давали на Великдень зернята і більш нічого. Мамусю, у нас дівчата поквічали в кімнаті, травички постелили, та тільки плачем, бо погода дуже плоха, дощі вже 3 неділі, і нема де розвеселитись. Сидимо та плачемо. На трійцю 2 дні наробили, татусю, мамусю, я ще жива поки, і Маруся зі мною, і Ялософетка. Передаємо усі свій привіт. Описуйте мені своє життя, чи вже є ягоди, чи картошка молода, чи пообсажувались. Що мій дорогий братичок робить, Альошка і Вася? Хоч слово за них хочу побачити на папері. Дорогі мої мамусю, чи ви застеляєте зіллячком на цей щасливий день? Чи робите сьогодні? Яка погода? Поки до світ нема де писати, а новості є.
Letter written on the 13th of June, 1943. A letter to my dear and never forgotten Papasha, Mamasha, and beloved brothers Vasunya and Adyoshka. I greet all of you, my dearest ones, on the day of Holy Trinity as I write this postcard, early on the morn of Trinity Sunday, while everyone in the room is still sleeping. Oh, dear Mama, as I'm writing, my bitter tears flow when I remember that I'm so far from you. It makes me weep. Though maybe now it's not all honey and milk at home, but still it's home. Oh God, when I remember springtime at the collective farm, how joyful it was to work. My, the soul grows numb, Now Easter passed, and we haven't even seen any Easter bread or a painted egg. They gave us some seeds for Easter, and that's all. Dear Mama, the girls decorated our room with flowers. They spread fresh grass on the floor, but all we do is weep because the weather is very bad. It's been raining for 3 weeks, and there's nowhere to go and make merry. So we sit and cry for the Trinity. We have 2 days off. Tato, Mama, I'm still alive, and Marusha is with me, and Yalo Sovietka. We all send our greetings. Describe your life to me. Do you have berries already and young potatoes? Have you finished planting? How are my little brothers, Alyoshka and Vasya? Send me word about them. I want to see it on paper. Dear Mama, do you still decorate the house with herbs on this joyous day? Or are you working? How's the weather? Goodbye for now. There's no place to write, yet there's news.
And then I will conclude by a few poems from the Jewish correspondence. As I mentioned before, these are also documentaries, poeticized materials that the Jews were sending after the war, to looking for their relatives who remained in the villages, occupied villages in Ukraine, and of course all were murdered, but they were still looking what happened to them. And these are very short, like telegrams, very short messages. Прошу вас повідомити, чи живий і чи проживає мій батько, матір в містечку Дашів Вінницької області.
I hereby request to inform me whether my father, mother are alive and whether they still live in Dashiv of the Vinnytska Oblast.
У містечку Дашів 2 січня 42 року всі закреслено по звірячому розстріляні. Рідних ваших немає, будинок рідних ваших зайнятий місцевими мешканцями.
In the town of Dashiv, 2-1-42, all censored, brutally murdered. Your relatives are no more. The house of your relatives is occupied by local residents.
Здравствуйте, дорогі сусіди. Даю точну відповідь. Ваше сімейство, містечко Дашів, батько, мати, сестра і дочка забрали німецькі гади. Там були розстріляні всі містечка в кількості. Затим до побачення. Залишаємося всі живі і здорові. Ваш сусід.
Greetings, dear neighbors. I hereby give a precise answer. Your family in the town of Dashiv, father, mother, sister, and daughter, have been taken by the German vipers. There, all the towns had been executed in the number of. So for now, farewell. Let us all stay alive and in good health. Your neighbor.
And there is another poem, which is, well, it's a poem based on the. I was looking for all the people who were murdered in Dashiv, and I have a list, very long list, and I included it in the book, but I will read just a short excerpt of this poem.
Бахурінська Сара розстріляна, Купчеленький Сруль розстріляний, Лінецький Лейб розстріляний, Махорінський Мехел, Шуня, Гріша, Шима, Гітля, Люба, Синя розстріляні. Страпоніков Борис і Роза розстріляні. Мешенбон, Хатя, Ханя, Соня, Клара розстріляні. Айнбіндер, Йосип розстріляний. Бачкуринський Бетя, Мір'ям, Хая, Соня розстріляні. Заїка, Дувид, Абрам, Міхел, Сима, Рудол розстріляні. Улицький Естер, Феня, Клара, Олтер, Юзя, Фіма, Моше, Борис – розстріляні на цукровому заводі та скинуті у яму. Побережський Пінхус Нега, Яків, Сруль Пінхас – розстріляні. Резніки Мошко, Сима, Клара, Борис – розстріляні. Талаєвські Маня, Софія, Ріва, Сара – розстріляні. Талалаєвські Клара, Туба, Мойсей, Люсік, Яків, Ріва, Соня, Маня, Мойше, Лейба, Хана, Гріша, Соня – розстріляні.
Averbuch довід, вбитий душогубці. Файнштейни, Ліба, Нехома, Соня, Сима, Янкель, Натан, Хайм розстріляні. Улицький Міша розстріляний на цукровому заводі. Бій ховався, був відданий поліцаями. Поліцаєм розстріляний, Шутіни, Йосип, Хайм, Клара, Хана, кинуті в колодязь і розстріляні. Василевський, Маня, Дора, Іта, Айзек, Шимон розстріляні. На Перегонівському цукровому заводі Голубчанський Григорій розстріляний у братській могилі край дороги між Дашевом та Ілінцями. Богомольні Сура, Хана, Мойше, Соня, Таня, Борис розстріляні. Бреннери, Шая, Броніслава розстріляні. В Монастирському концтаборі Бреннер Бася розстріляна за наказом Гітлера. Школьник Абрам з жінкою та дітьми розстріляні. Камінський Айзек із дітьми розстріляні. Шухат Лея розстріляна на світанку разом із усім Дашевом. Гольштейн Мотл вбитий українцем, у якого мешкав прізвище невідоме, ім'я невідомо, розстріляний. Малка розстріляна, Женя розстріляна, Зіна розстріляна. Дора з батьками намагалася вирватися з Вінниці на подводі, вбито прямим попаданням бомби. Прізвище невідоме, ім'я невідомо, розстріляний. Прізвище невідоме, ім'я невідоме. Розстріляна, прізвище невідоме, ім'я невідомо, розстріляний, прізвище невідоме, ім'я невідоме, розстріляний, розстріляні, вбиті, розстріляні, вбиті, задушені в душегубці, скинуті в колодязь, убиті, розстріляні, знищені, розстріляні, задушені в душегубці, ліквідовані, вбиті, скинуті в колодязь живими, страчені, розстріляні, прізвище вбито, ім'я розстріляно. Прізвище, ім'я скинуті у колодязь, ім'я невідомо, розстріляний, розстріляні, вбиті, задушені в душегубці, прізвище невідоме, ім'я невідоме, задушена в душегубці, вбита, розстріляна, прізвище невідоме, ім'я невідомо, вбитий, прізвище невідомо, ім'я невідомо, вбиті, прізвище невідомо, ім'я невідомо, відомо, 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 невідомо, відомо, відомо. Відомо мені, відомо, відомо нам, відомо, відомо все. Ізгадел, Віскаде, Шмейра, Бобелмо, Діврохі Русей, Ваямліх Малхусей, Вецмах, Поркуней, Корем, Шіхей, Бихайхен, Увеєй Майхен, Увихаєй, Дехол, Бейс, Ісроел, Багало, Увізман, Корі, Веймру, Омейн, Єйшмора, Бо, Ворах лолам уле оломей, олмайо, ізборех, вейштабех, вейспоєр, все ісраймом, вейснасей, вейсадор, вейсале, вейсалол, шмейдекучо, бріх, улейло, мінкол, бірхосо, вечеросо, тужбехосо, венехемосо, дамірон, болмо, веймру, омейн, єйшмола, бо, Міншмайо, вихаїм тейвім, олейну, велкол Ісраїл, вимру, омейн. Ясе шолом, вимру, маву, ясе шолом, олейну, велкол Ісраїл, вимру, омейн.
Бахурінська Сера, шат. Купчаленкі Срул, шат. Лонецькі Лів, шат. Махаринський Михел Шунія Хріша, Шима Гітлія Люба Синя Шат, Страпоніка Борис і Роза Шат, Мешен Бонхана Соня Клара Шат, Айнбендер Йосип Шат, Улицький Естер Феня Клара Олтер Їзя Фіма Моша Борис Шат at a sugar factory and dumped into a pit. Lenetsky Lisa Lieb Leia Shot Spivak Ben Sion Chaya Basha Shot Babareshki Pinkus Necha Yakiv Srul Pinkas Shot Resnik Moshka Sema Clara Boris Shot Talaevsky Manya Sofia Riva Sarah Shot Averbuch Duvid killed in a gas van Lieberman Shot Manshenzon Rosa Dora Hana Shot Rosenberg Moisha Holda Shot Umanovsky shot, Roman Myler shot, Ohrabinsky Etia, Yakiv Ksil, Kus, Sonia Tolia shot, Khmurov, Riva, Boris, Tolia shot, Ulitsky Misha shot at a sugar factory, ran off and hid, handed over to the Polizei, and shot Shutin, Yosip, Chaim, Clara, Hana, thrown into a well, and shot Cherubinsky, Basha, Halia, Leia, Monia shot, Eman, Berko, Maya, Sonia shot, Tendler, Joma, Schott, Vasilevsky, Manya, Dora, Ita, Isaac, Shimon, shot at Perahonev Sugar Factory. Holobochansky, Grigori, shot in a mass grave at the edge of the road between Dashev and Ilinsi, Ostrovsky, Avrum, shot, Brenner, Shaya, Branislava, shot in the Monastirshe concentration camp, Brenner, Basha, shot on Hitler's orders, Shkolnik, Abram, shot with his wife and children, Kaminsky, Isaac, shot with children, Shuchat, Leah, shot at dawn with the whole city of Dashev, Goldstein, Motel, killed by a Ukrainian at whose place he lived, last name unknown, Malka, shot, Zhenya, shot, Zina, shot, Dora tried to escape from Venezia on a cart with her parents. She was killed by a bomb in a direct hit. Krisha, together with his daughter and wife, and with her parents, tried to escape from Venezia on a cart. He killed by a bomb in a direct hit, trying to escape from Venezia on a cart with her parents, grandmother and grandfather. Schneherski, Moshe, Edel, shot, last name unknown, name unknown. He shot, last name unknown. Name unknown, she shot, last name unknown, name unknown, she shot, last name unknown, names unknown, they shot, last name unknown, names unknown, they shot, last name unknown, name unknown, he shot, last name unknown, names unknown, they shot, last name unknown, name unknown, she shot, last name unknown, unknown, name unknown, he shot, last name unknown, name unknown. She shot, last name unknown, he shot, last name unknown, they shot, last name unknown, he shot, name unknown, he shot, they shot, killed, suffocated to death in a gas van, thrown into a well, killed, shot, wiped out, shot, suffocated to death in a gas van, liquidated, killed, thrown alive into a well, executed, shot, name unknown, last name killed, name shot, last name thrown into a well, last name unknown, she got suffocated in a gas chamber, killed, shot, they got killed, last name unknown, known, 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 unknown, known, 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 known to me, known, known to us, known, everything is known.
Любий брате Довід, життя – боротьба. Той в ній воїн, хто в житті суворий і спокоєн. Йду на смерть спокійно завтра. О 8 годині нас розстріляють біля Дашівської школи. Помстися за нас, твоя гарячолюбіща сестра Фріда. 19 грудня 41-го року. Прощавай. Дуже дякую.
Beloved brother David, life is a battle and she is a warrior who in life remains stern and composed. I go calmly to my death tomorrow. At 8 they will execute us by the Dashev school building. Avenge us. Your fervently loving sister, Frida, 19th of December, 1941. Farewell.
I think first, a round of applause for this. And thank you so much to Valerie for reading in English the translations by Oksana Maksimchuk and Max Russochinsky. As you can see, this is a masterpiece. We have a little bit of time left, so I think I'm going to give the floor to the people in the audience who have so patiently waited and who have packed this room to ask a few questions. So maybe we'll collect a couple of questions at a time and then let you answer and then go again. And introduce yourself for everyone, please.
Thank you for for people in the audience who doesn't know, the last Hebrew piece, that's the Kaddish traditional Jewish prayer at the end of the service related to the people who passed away. Traditional. Well, question about the letters of Ukrainians coming from, this is just dawned to me. the letters coming from Germany to Ukraine, meaning it was used by the German post office, right, mm-hmm. during the Nazi time. This has just got to me. I have absolutely no idea how that was done. Like, was it the, like looked at, it was just sent, and definitely stopped as soon as Soviets came. Any idea about that, how those letters, what happened?
Well, the letters were sent to the occupied territories, so these were, the postal service was operating very well, and was used for propaganda, actually, because they, of course, all the letters were censored, like both ends, in Germany and in Ukraine, mm-hmm. but it was possible to send letters. Ostarbeiters were restricted to use 2 postcards per month, 10, 15 lines, these were postcards with 2 sides, so they were like folded, and they wrote down the back address, and only to this address the relatives were allowed to send a message. But they also were allowed to send packages, for example. So the postal office, the postal service was functioning very well.
Mm-hmm. Okay, next question. Please.
It is actually a question regarding the very first piece, genealogy. I heard in the middle, maybe didn't clear, but you mentioned Svetaya Troitsa. And in I understand that the later on, in the time, after his generation, it was kind of mixture of, but seems to me this was mentioned way before when it was still Jewish. How come this is Christian symbol?
This is a geographical, this is a toponym.
Oh, it is not.
No, it's not Svetak Trits, the Holy Trinity.
It's some specific place.
Yes, it's a village, yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I didn't know this village was this name. This name.
Yeah.
Stephanie and then George. Stephanie was first.
Mm-hmm. Because it was just to this that I also wanted to ask about, because I think you said Okopis Svetoi Trici,
yes.
Okopis Svetoi Trici is a topos from Polish literature.
Mm-hmm.
It is, I don't know if, how. I mean, obviously there are connections, clearly, because you speak also of a Polish grandmother.
Uh-huh.
But in the play or drama by Zygmunt Kwasinski, Nieboska Komedia, this is the final stand of the gentry against the uprising peasantry, which are red and crypto-Bolshevik and Jewish.
Well, in my case, it's more simple. It's just a place, a town where Baal Shem Tov was born. So it's the founder of Hasidism. He was born there. So in 18th century. So that's why I mentioned.
Very interesting.
First of all, thank you, Alex, Valerie, Oleh. It's very powerful. Thank you. Thank you for writing it, and thank you for sharing it. I had a question, the comment about the Kaddish prayer. I didn't know whether, Valerie, the translation that you read simply cut that part off, or whether that was left out of the English.
Yeah, she didn't read it, yes. Yeah, but only I read the Kaddish.
And is it in, does it stay in Hebrew and English? Or did they translate it?
No, it's not translated. Uh-huh. It's Arabic, yeah.
Good. So you mentioned that there were other prayers, and that's such a powerful gesture, especially there. But it made me wonder if your work is in conversation in any way with Boris Hersonsky's Semeny Arkhiv, which also integrates prayers and changes them sometimes. And it is quite shocking to the eye to see them transliterated into Cyrillic, actually. And I didn't know if it
Yes, of course. I'm aware of his work and read this book. Not sure if I'm in a conversation with his poetry. I know that yes, mm-hmm. he used it, and in my perception, I use it in a slightly different way. But yes, he's a great poet, and the book is just fascinating. Mm-hmm. And of course, I mean, we are both Ukrainian Jewish authors, so there might be some connections that I even don't see, but they are there.
Right. Any other questions? Please go ahead.
Thank you. I'm wondering about the Ostarbeiter poems. Do you, and I have so many questions about the postcards themselves, like where are they, how did you access them, have other people use them? Perhaps we can leave those aside for now, but is each poem based on a single postcard, or do you do some fusion, or I'm interested in kind of the relationship between the finished poem and the original text, and what kind of process you've gone through now that I've heard them?
Oh yeah, I mix sometimes a few letters and sometimes you know, what does it mean to poeticize? Yes, they are mixed. They are partially there, and they are partially mine. And this is a co-authorship. I mean, I don't know who is the author. The very definition of authorship. Of the author is very, very problematic here, because I perceive myself as a combinator of this. So what I'm doing, I'm working with like a collage, but I'm not the author. And actually, the book, so the copyright notion, it mentions Averbuch et al. So I do, it's important to acknowledge the authorship of other people, and so it's an honor to represent these voices that you represented, but probably not enough, and in different contexts.
Okay, one last question.
Thank you very much. It's very powerful, and thank you for working with history. It provides the emotional dimension that is really absent in most of the work of history, and provides a different type of understanding. The question that I have is, I felt that a lot was lost in translation. And what I mean specifically is that there is Surjik there is Russian and Ukrainian, and And then there is Yiddish, and it opens completely different worlds, and which are not there in English. And I wonder whether there are techniques, whether there are other ways also to bring in this additional layers that are in the original, bring it also to the English language reader, listener. I suppose it is very difficult, but I think maybe there are some ways how to interact.
Yeah, thank you. We discussed this. This was also Valerie's question. So it sounds very, very. The translation is very literal. But yes, our decision was, I didn't want to include these poems at all in the English book, and Oksana and Max, they did, you are right. It's almost undoable. Maybe it is to convey Surjik. It will be not. It won't be Surjik. It will be another broken language, English, which imitates something that we have with Surjik. But what we decided eventually that we will, since it's a bilingual book, the reader will still have the Ukrainian the Ukrainian text, and the English will be just that academic translation. So we didn't translate all the poems, all the Ostarbeiters' poems, but only those poems that have more interesting details. So the language, unfortunately, yes, is gone there. And but I'm happy that it will be at least side by side with the English translations. But
and just to, for those interested, just to mention that this book is forthcoming from Lost Horse Press, either this year or early next year. Is that right?
Yeah, we are still working on it. I'm not sure whether based on next year, but sometime it will come. We have the translations. We have almost all the poems were published in various journals in English translations. So we are still considering the project as a future book. It's a process.
Well, so we're concluding the event. Unfortunately, we're out of time. Poetry lives when poetry is performed. Poetry needs to be read, needs to be heard, and I think all of us experienced today how powerful it was today. I personally was extremely struck by that image of the appeal to God. How can you sit on your throne, right? You effed up again, right? And it's just so powerful. This kind of, it's so archetypal, this address to God. And I feel that it has a lot of kind of Shevchenko gesture in it that George often speaks about. And so I think definitely that we need to read this poetry, we need to perform it, we need to experience it in order to appreciate it. In 2 weeks, we will have another Jewish-Ukrainian poet here, Ilya Kiva, who will be reading from her forthcoming book with us. So I invite you to check out that event on our calendar and our website, Ilya Kiva, October 11th. You can go to our website, huri.harvard.edu, and look it up. We are very lucky that we're able to have other partners co-sponsor these events. So today's event was co-sponsored with the Department of Slavic Languages and Literatures, with the Davis Center for Russian and Eurasian Studies, and the Center for Jewish Studies. And our forthcoming event, our future event with Ilya Kiva on October 11th at 6 p.m., will be also co-sponsored with the Slavic Department.
And I do have a couple of, few copies of this book, so I'm not in English translation yet, but the original.
Yes. So there are a couple of copies there. If anyone is interested, speak to Alex. Thank you very much for coming. Please continue joining us. So wonderful to have you in this little cozy space, talking about really difficult stuff. And it really hits very close, I feel, for all of us, but we should be able to talk about this and we should be able to experience this. So I'm very grateful to Alex for agreeing to do this. I'm super grateful to Valerie for helping us with reading the English originals. And thank you to all of us for coming. I hope to see you next time. Thank you very much.